the High Country Horseman had to be a tough man. He had to make the right decisions. One wrong decision, quite often in those days, meant death.
My name is Charlie Lovick. I'm a fifth generation mountain cattleman. These are some of the stories of the High Country and the history of my family. Some of these stories have been handed down to me by my father and other family members. Some of them come from my brother John.
I just couldn't go any further. The horse couldn't go any further. There was logs down, there was rubbish down from the previous winter snow, and it's pitch black. And I was fairly cacking myself because I did not know where I was. The cattle had gone.
Some of them from my wife, Glenda.
Lily and Tilly Lovick were Charlie's great aunts, and they used to take horse riders up to Mount Buller and really enjoy their time, and they were the first women that went to Buller on horses. They were probably the first women doing a lot of things in the High Country.
My daughter Kelly.
Bushes right up to his tummy, right up past my knees and that, and he was 17 hands. And Dad said, watch out for holes, because, you know, we can't see, the horses can't see, so just watch out. Anyway, Dad turns around and stops for a second. Lurch just steps aside. We fall down a hole, and Lurch and myself fell down straight through it.
An old mate, Stick Beamish.
It was a law of the bush. You always left to dry firewood in the hut. So if they got there in a wet night, they could light a fire. There'd be food, there'd be tins of, you know, camp pie or soup and stuff like that, so no one would starve, they could get a feed there. If they
got my nephew Kane, amongst others.
My grandfather Jack, he wanted to be in the era before he was born, in the pioneering days. And if he could have lived up in the High Country at Lovick's Hut, he'd live there. There's no two ways about that.
These stories are of experiences that have become legends. Stories about survival, about rescue, and these stories are still here to be told. Every time you come to the High Country, you'll sit down around a campfire and you'll listen and hear these stories, and you'll know they're true. Victoria's High Country is about one third of the state. Of that one third, the snow-capped areas, I suppose, is about a third of that again. And it just so happens that the Victorian part of the Great Divide is the most spectacular, the most savage. It is. It's what's called the True Divide. The area of Mount Howitt, Mount King Billy, sheds more rivers north and south than any other part of the Great Divide, so Victoria is the main watershed. I really can remember back to a very early age, and I was probably 4 years old, I can distinctly remember getting up one morning at the Merrigee Hotel, which was our family home, which had been started and pioneered by our family in 1873. I remember getting up and was stunned to see my father and six or eight big old bushmen, and everybody at that stage seemed big and hairy and old, and they were outside the Merrigee Hotel. They had a pack horse each, and the pack horses were loaded, and then they just turned and meandered away, and they were gone for about 14 days. And then I remember them one afternoon all getting off the horses, and my older brother and sister going and helping unsaddle the horses and wash them down, and everybody asking questions and huge excitement. 10 or a dozen barking dogs, and at the back there was two blokes walking in, and they had two big Hereford bulls on ropes, and they were bringing it back in, and I thought, what the hell is this? What it turned out to be later was that once a year, my dad and all his mates and the rest of the family, the older people, would go into the bush and catch wild cattle and bring them back. And after that subsided, I remember listening in the pub to all the tales and whatever happened about catching these cattle, and I thought, that's for me. I want to go with these blokes. I'd try and hide in pack bags. I'd do anything I damn well could to get there. And I suppose that's why this river country and the mountains are in my blood. It was just instilled into me from the first of my early memories. I suppose you've got to go back to how the Lovicks first got here. First old fellow was sent out from England and he got sent to Van Diemen's Land for 7 years for stealing a loaf of bread. And in those early convict days, if you could befriend a woman and get married, you're allowed out earlier so you could help populate the country. And he must have been a handsome lad like myself, and found a local lass and was allowed out and got married. He got back to Victoria, had 7 kids, and he must have been a crook because he called his first one Thomas Crook Lovick. The older one of these first boys, William Mitchell Lovick, decided that the early city of Melbourne was no good for him. And around about that time, 1860, gold had been discovered here in the Howkill River. So he hightailed it to Merrijig and followed the gold to the Howkill River and became a miner. There wasn't much money in digging gold, so he thought the best thing to do was start a little shanty pub. But by the time the late 1880s come, he was the last bloke left because there was no bloody gold, no miners. All he was left with was a great heap of titles to a few blocks. So he left it all behind and went back to Merrijig. And from then on, he married, and so sprang the Lovicks from there. And we've kept on going ever since. I better have another drink. Oh, shut up, Steve. We'll end up flattening
you
tonight.
Let's get Stick story.
I'll tell you one thing. I met Stick when I was, what, six, seven?
Seven.
He still remembers. And he looked exactly like that. But oh, he's got this recollection of all those old blokes looking like that. Even in those days, they just don't change. I'm sort of talking, what, 40-something years ago, aren't I, Stick? 50
years ago.
50, oh, well, you get there, stretching
it
a bit.
How old are you?
53. How old are you?
53.
Are you asleep or what? just checking on. Sometimes he just drifts off a bit like that. If you look back at Merrijig in 1860 onwards, there's probably 4 main families that decided that cattle will be our go, we'll provide food for the miners. And they would have been the Lovicks, the McCormicks, the Purcells and the Hearns. You know, we were talking about country that was fairly heavily timbered even back through Merrijig, Mansfield. There was no great rolling plains. This was harsh country. And they looked anywhere to develop new grazing areas so they could grow more cattle to feed more people. And that's what took them into the high country to look for summer grazing. And those families are still there today doing pretty much the same thing as they did in 1860.
My old man, he learned his craft basically from an uncle. His father, George, was not so much of a bushman, but George's brother, Frank, he was the uncle. He was the one that basically took Dad out and got him into the bush style of life. Actually, Dad inherited his cattle, and Frank used to run cattle out here. Frank's father would have taught Frank, I mean, it goes back for many generations, this bush style of life.
Mount Lovick was named after Frank Lovick, but other members of the family too were well recognised in the high country, but Frank was the legendary bushman of the Lovick family that came before my old man Jack. And he was the first man really to take cattle onto this Great Divide country. Other people had taken cattle out and had them out there for a year or two and decided to pull them out and said, it's too hard, it's too tough. Frank came out and made it his own country. And the stories of Frank mustering cattle on the bluff end, which is a very big mountain here which you rode past today. And he was snowed in with cattle there one year. There's a cleft that goes down between the two main points of the bluff end called the blowhole. It's a very, very steep grassy chute that goes down between the two rock faces. And he decided the only way off the mountain with the cattle was to take them down that. Now that's a feat that no man had ever attempted or would attempt. But by himself, he took his 27 head, I think it was, and got them off down into the Hauquay River and got them out home. And that was, you know, turn of the century. Now, as good as my old man was, that's something he never attempted. Because your horse would have just slid. Cattle slid, the horse would have slid. No doubt he would have got off and let it down in spots. It was them sort of blokes that put together the knowledge that's allowed us to continue on and show it to other people. First part of today's ride is we're going to traverse this low point of the Great Divide and out onto Mount Magdala. There you can see out here to your east, and it's pretty sheer down this side. You get up there and you look, you think you're looking out the window of an aircraft. You got nothing but valley underneath you. So it's pretty hairy, but it's a very good view when we get out on top. We get down here onto this little saddle. You've got the head of the Hauquay River on your left-hand side and the McAllister River on your right-hand side. So that is the true divide. It splits Gippsland and northeast Victoria, so you're standing right on it. You can imagine what the first old Lovicks thought when they got back to the top of the honeycomb and they looked out over here and said, well, that's where we want to be. Then they had to make that track down through the saddle and up this side, and it's hard enough now after 100 years of bridle track going in, and then they would have got to this spot here and said, there's that giant bluff in front of us, how do we get over that? And they wouldn't have done it in the day. They would have camped here for a week and come out each day and have a look for another track and walk up and shift a couple of rocks and get back and get their horses, and they just struggled on and on and on and on. If it hadn't been for them doing that, we wouldn't be here today. So there must have been really some want in them to just keep pushing on. But every time they get to a new high point, they'd see some more way in the distance and they'd say, well, we want to go and have a look there too.